To celebrate and reflect on the publication of Professor Obery M. Hendricks Jr.'s newest book, The Universe Bends Toward Justice. Now, as many of you probably already know, Professor Hendricks is a professor of biblical studies interpretation at New York Theological Seminary and a visiting scholar in religion and African American studies at Columbia. He's a former Wall Street executive, and he's the author of a widely received book, The Politics of Jesus, Rediscovering the Revolutionary Nature of Jesus' Teachings and How They Have Been Corrupted. Now, like this book, The Politics of Jesus, his newest book, The Universe Bends Towards Justice, is a provocative book that raises questions about the role of Christianity plays in conferring power to the already powerful and legitimizing the state of the poor in the nation. Now, as he writes in the opening pages of the book, we are living in insane times. Like the purveyors of a bad Orwellian joke, the religious right and the right-wing politicians have hijacked the meanings of justice and equality and cynically perverted them into very opposites. The Hebrew Bible and the Gospel of Jesus both command all who hold them dear to care for the poor, the weak, the vulnerable. Yet right-wing politicians and prosperity preachers shamelessly interpret the Bible in ways that serve America's rich and ignores the sufferings of the poor. Now, that's just the first few sentences of the book. There's a lot more of critiques of that type. And so what he does in his book is explores the gap in the spirituality of Jesus and the spirituality of the contemporary church. He also explores how aspects of contemporary gospel music, as he argues, sensationalizes the way the church relates to issues of social and political justice. The book also explores, importantly, I think, in these times, how American capitalism and the politics of the religious right betray the basic foundations of Christianity. So in my view, Professor Hendricks continues in a great tradition of Christian dissenters, theologians like Emerson Fosdick, one of my favorite theologians, Howard Thurman, and of course Martin Luther King, who I think inspired the title of this book, given the line, the bend toward justice is one of the themes that King continuously raised in his speeches. Tonight we will start off by introducing our roundtable participants. First, just throw your hands up, we're not going in necessary order, is Professor Barbara D. Savage, who is the Geraldine R. Siegel Professor of American Social Thought and Professor of History in the at University of Pennsylvania, where she has taught since 1995. Her most recent book, Your Spirits Walk Beside Us, The Politics of Black Religion, published by Harvard University Press, is an historical examination of debates about the public responsibility of black churches and the role of religion in racial leadership. Professor Savage received her doctorate at Yale and holds a law degree from Georgetown University and received her undergraduate degree at the University of Virginia. Reverend Dr. Serene Jones. She is the 16th president of the historic Union Theological Seminary here in New York. She is the first woman to head the 174-year-old non-denominational seminary. Professor Jones came to Union from Yale University, where she was professor of theology at the Divinity School there and chair of the Women, Gender, and Sexuality Studies at the Graduate School of Arts and Sciences. She holds degrees from the University of Oklahoma, Yale Divinity School, as well as another degree from Yale University. Dr. Jones is ordained in the Christian Church, Disciples of Christ, and the United Church of Christ. And also, I have to say, Professor Jones has pulled off a coup We understand yesterday she will be bringing Professor Cornell West to Union next fall. Pastor Mike, I was just told I can call him Pastor Mike. You guys already know him. Okay. He is a native of Freeport, New York, and is the pastor here at First Corinthian Baptist Church. He attended Morehouse College, where he earned a Bachelor of Arts degree in philosophy and religion. While at Morehouse, Pastor Mike accepted his call to the ministry, and since that time, he has preached and lectured at various churches and conferences throughout the country. He also attended Duke University School of Divinity, where he earned a Master of Divinity degree. He is the pastor, I understand, one of the most popular churches here in Harlem. And we're very glad that he's and the congregation is hosting us this evening. So with that, let's get started. We will now hear a brief statement, opening statement by Professor Hendricks. So that's where the way we will go. And we will follow then with statements from each of our panelists, no more than 7 to 10 minutes. And then Professor Hendricks will then respond to those comments, questions. And then finally, we will open the audience up for questions. Over.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor Harris. And my name is Obery M. Hendricks, Jr. Obery M. Hendricks, Sr., whose namesake and only son I am, was born in 1926 on the outskirts of Farmville, Virginia, where almost three decades later, I would also first draw breath. In 1926, black life was extremely cheap everywhere in America, but especially so in places like Farmville. William Vandenhoeven, who as Robert Kennedy's assistant attorney general was dispatched to Farmville in 1960 to try to reopen the public schools that whites had closed rather than desegregate, and who later served this nation as ambassador to South Africa, several years ago shared with me that white supremacy in Farmville was more deeply entrenched than anything he had seen even in Soweto. In this closed swelter of truncated lives and strivings, even dreams seemed to be banned, much less real prospects. So Obery Hendricks Sr. left home in the ninth grade to eke out a subsistence as a railroad porter, rather than choke on the peasant farm dust that had consumed his father, eventually leaving the rails to learn the bricklayer's trade, at which he proudly toiled for the rest of his life. He moved his little family, my mom and me, my sister Linda, graced our lives later. He moved us from Farmville to the promised land of Newark to find there, to his everlasting heartbreak, the only things those who controlled those concrete cities did promise to throbbing black wishful hearts. That is daily exploitation, daily insult, daily disdain, and daily dismissal of his humanity. Every day I watched him leave before the crow of the cock to return, exhausted from the rigors of his labor, exhausted from struggling to keep his dignity intact, exhausted from biting his tongue so he could be granted yet another day's exhausting struggle to feed his family. I watched him hide his defeat with wan smiles when yet another of his dreams was thwarted, then watched him gulp Maalox from the bottle to calm the ulcer his brave facade could not fool. Sometimes he could not hide his pain. On those days, his shoulders stooped just a bit, his head dipped ever so light, ever so slightly, and he sighed more than usual. Yet his dignity never slipped. Like so many men and women then, and so many men and women of all colors today, he suffered in silence beneath the weight of his ironclad social immobility, in a society that did not care that he had a heart and that it bled. So yes, I watched racism hack away at his spirit, but it was never racism alone. It was also elitism, classism, class warfare waged in the name of the Bible, the flag, and the divine right of the wealthy and powerful to remain wealthy and powerful. But equally culpable was the church, the mainstream church that proclaimed its rights to everyone's allegiance, whether actively supporting the political economic system that any Sadducee would love, or tacitly supporting that system by failing to stand against it or even denounce it, the church to whom my father gave his heart failed him. It was a self-righteous yet complicit partner in the exploitive political and economic apparatus that drained women and men like him of their labor and the lifeblood of their dreams, like a company of vampire bats clad in pinstripe suits or ornate clerical garb, according to their fashion. It is because my father dreamed as hard as anyone and worked harder than most, yet was thwarted by a political, social, and economic system for which he was only fodder. It is for this that I have written. I have written as well because all his life he believed in and served the church, its proclamations, and its feverishly performed music, and as his churchly reward received the preached delusion that it was adherence to doctrinal orthodoxy that would save him, and then only in the by and by. And I have written the universe bends toward justice because, like Ishmael Reed, I too believe that writing is fighting. If we who claim not to be deluded in our faith and in our spirits are to rescue the liberating power of the prophetic witness from the backward foolishness proclaimed in its name, so justice can roll down like waters and righteousness like a mighty stream, then we must free the egalitarian ethos of the justice-draped prophetic witness from the pervasive ideological clutches of the backward and too often hateful conservative Christian right wing, the deceitful, self-serving clutches of the conservative political right wing, and the greedy, exploitive clutches of the conservative economic right wing. I admit that I have written this book out of hurt, but I've also written it out of hope. Like Martin Luther King Jr., whose quotation graces this book's title, I too have no choice but to believe that the arc of the universe is long, but it bends toward justice. And so I have written, and so I will endeavor to act, and so I hope we will all endeavor to act. I'd like to thank my colleagues at the Institute for Research in African American Studies at Columbia for staging this event, New York and Union Theological Seminaries for so graciously co-sponsoring this event, and Pastor Waldron and the people of First Corinthians for opening their home to us. I also offer my humblest thanks and appreciation to my colleagues on this panel for doing me and my work the great honor of discussing it. And I thank you all for honoring us with your presence. And finally, I thank my wife, Dr. Farah Jasmine Griffin, for the role she's played in freeing these ideas in my head and bringing this event to fruition. Thank you.
Yeah. Dr. Jones.
I was trying to reverse the order.
Oh.
No, that's okay. I'm now choking.
That's a good way to get out of it.
Professor Sager.
Shall I go?
That would be great.
Okay. Never seen that done before. You okay?
Yes, I'm okay.
Well, I'm very grateful to be here and just want to echo the thanks from Dr. Hendricks to, first, to all of you for coming out tonight, certainly to First Corinthian for hosting us, and to all of the academic sponsors as well. I think this symbolizes the joining together of groups and interests that ought to be joined together and that benefit one from another by being in each other's company. So I also, of course, want to thank Dr. Hendricks for doing the hard work of putting ideas to paper. You know, as scholars and teachers, I tell my students all the time that writing is the most difficult thing that we do. And so we're very grateful to him for the effort that results in this book and for all that it has begun to teach us. When I read the book, it seems to be primarily, in some way, a call for a return to the basics. In some ways, a call for a new fundamentalism in the most literal sense of the word. I think today when we use the word fundamentalist, we reflexively connect it to a rigidity and sometimes to a kind of fanaticism. And that's not what I have in mind, and that's not what I mean. But what if we who call ourselves Christians were to make a return to the fundamental teachings of Jesus? What if there were a true back to basics movement? That idea is a oversimplification, of course, of the eloquence and the erudition of Dr. Hendricks' newest book, but at its essence, that's how I would decomplexify what he is arguing here, as he has elsewhere in other work. But more to the point, that's how I would explain his teachings to us and to those who may not have yet read the work. What is so potent in the book to me, however, is that we follow that call for a radical return to the gospel's message through his work and his training as a biblical scholar and an analyst of contemporary Christian popular culture and as a student of the classics. But most of all, what I hear in this book is a clarion call for us who call ourselves Christians to respond. It's a call and response. This is a call for us as Christians to respond, to do something, to radically rethink how we act as Christians. This book is not a polemic, or I should say it is not a mere polemic, because it is also that in the purest sense. A polemic being an aggressive attack and a disputation of prevailing views and practices and ideas. But it's much more than that. It is, as he reminds us, a manifesto, a denunciation that also calls upon us to act and to act now. And that's what I want to say a few more words about tonight. Those of us who write and teach about African American religion and its obligations to political community are especially grateful to have this book, written by someone who knows his Bible and its languages and who dares to question prevailing wisdom as the truer meanings of the Hebrew scriptures and the gospel of Jesus are brought closer to us. Those of us who study the African diaspora looking for the kind of connective tissue among Africa's scattered descendants have often invoked the concept of translation, a metaphor for this work of exploring and refining our connections and our misconnections and trying to find a way to renew connection. In a similar way, Dr. Hendricks' writings are driven by his own translations and his own close reflections on the deepest meanings and intentions of not only the scriptures, but of political economy and economic history. Linking the gospel's admonitions about helping the poor, Dr. Hendricks reminds us that, as he says, Jesus was re-articulating commands that stand at the heart of the Hebrew Bible tradition. These commands have three distinct purposes. One, to lessen, if not fully eliminate, the economic differences that already existed. Two, to guard against the further development of economic class differences in society. And three, to protect the poor and vulnerable against exploitation by the rich and powerful. The radical notion of egalitarianism, of equality of opportunity and access, and of communal care for one another, including those who have the least in terms of material wealth, is our call and is our obligation and is our duty as Christians. That message and this translation reminds us, brings us back to the question of how we make manifest today the enduring clarity of these commands and of those commandments. So here we sit tonight in this hallowed, beautiful space. What is it that we are called now to do? How do we follow Jesus and not merely praise Jesus? This book is a scholar's plea that we follow a revolutionary path to liberate our neighbors and ourselves, to help us treat the needs of the poor, the jobless, the hungry, the homeless, to treat those needs as holy and as a holy obligation for us to act, as he says, to change this world into God's kingdom of justice here and now and on earth as it is in heaven. And for placing that demand upon us, I am forever in his debt. We owe it to him and to this work to come together and to move these ideas into action, person by person, church by church. And that is the manifesto that rests at the heart of this work, and I think that has propelled the eloquence and the quality of the work, and that leaves us with some obligation to answer in our own hearts and in our own lives, and certainly through our own actions and commitments.
So, Pastor Mike?
I'll finish up since I'm...
You want to finish up? Oh, okay. I'm not getting...
You know what, I'm going to... You rest. Let me first welcome everybody to First Corinthian. I'm thankful that Professor Hendricks wanted to come here because I think that doing so affords an opportunity for us to be engaged with the work that he has been led to do. And I'm thankful for those who've come, Dr. Jones and a friend of mine, Dr. Savage, who's here. And so I'm thankful for that. I come to this conversation with a tremendous passion for the church, and a passion that has slowly developed, firstly, as myself not being a willing participant. If I would have asked myself 20 years ago, would I be pastoring the church? My answer would have been no, because 20 years ago, I had a tremendous disdain for the work of the church, and I thought that the church was impotent to really affect the kind of change that I thought necessary in our culture, especially within the African-American community. But as I share with many people, I feel that God severely tricked me into this space, and once I went into the church and gave my heart to it, I found out that my running was in vain, that this was the place that God had called me to work. This was the environment in which I would teach, and the environment that would really, I think, not only as I look at it as someone who comes to it with something to offer, but in the church, unlike as Professor Hendricks talked about his father's experiences, that it has been in the church that I've experienced the kind of love that has loved me back to wholeness. And so I come to this with a tremendous, as I said, passion, and also a heart for the church, even in spite of its misgivings and the issues that plague so many of our churches. I thank Professor Hendricks for this text because it brings to awareness many issues that you will rarely find discussed in church, for the most part. And I would even say some issues that don't always get discussed in seminaries. And I'll say more about that later. One thing that the universe bends towards justice seeks to do, and something that I believe is essential, although Professor Hendricks doesn't put it in these words, but it seeks to radically recontextualize the ministry of Jesus. We have, for many years, almost seemingly a lifetime, witnessed the co-opting of Jesus's imagery and the co-opting of Jesus's name, but very rarely have we experienced a radical following of his teachings. And so I'm thankful to this text because it seeks to recontextualize, because so often in the decontextualizing process, we miss what is at the heart of Jesus's ministry, which is a ministry not just for poor people, but emerges among those who are impoverished, because Jesus is part of that class. And so I thank Professor Hendricks for reminding us that really to be who we claim to be as followers of Jesus, we are called to really reshape and reframe the ministry of Jesus in light of his own cultural context and historical context, so that we don't really, I think, do Jesus a disservice by seeking to embrace titles but not being really consumed with the work itself. I also am really drawn to the text because it continues to really take a prophetic streak in terms of pushing the church to reclaim its prophetic edge. That prophetic edge of the church is one that in many contexts has grown silent in contemporary culture in many ways, where the church is consumed with either the commodification of its own goods or participating in the performance, which Dr. Hendricks highlights in the first chapter, being consumed with performance with no power, performance over politics, and seeking to over-emotionalize what I think on some levels is a necessary cathartic moment. But I think looking at it the way Professor Hendricks does and seeking to reclaim the radical prophetic edge of the church as it needs to be one that renders a critique of the economic system, of the radical injustices that take place, the social inequalities that exist, I think is necessary. The other thing that I appreciate about this work is how it seeks to raise an alternative voice. If you listen today to much of political conservative talk that seeks to co-opt religious language, it gives the opinion that those who speak on behalf of God think one way. And in that way is not the way of those who struggle, who are suffering in this country, but it seeks to affirm the position and the power of the privileged. And I'm glad because this text reminds us that there are other voices. The problem is that those voices don't always have the access to platforms that those other voices seem to. And so bringing the kind of voice to the critiques of political conservatism, as well as the religious right, and as well as what, you know, Cornel West calls the kind of gangsterization of religious language, I think is necessary. And so for that work, Universe Bends Towards Justice, I think, is invaluable. And as Barbara said, I think it pushes us to a place, as she said, a back to the basics movement. That movement is taking place in many churches where there's, I know I can speak for First Corinthians, but that movement is taking place where we are seeking to recontextualize the ministry of Jesus and also take seriously our call to be prophetic. And I think prophetic, not in theory, but in praxis. And so I know it is easy to tell and speak of being prophetic without engaging one's body, but for me, being prophetic means the merging of theory and body. That fusion is necessary, or else any faith we proclaim is only a disembodied faith that has no real, real strength when it comes to transforming the plight of the masses of people in our country. So not only would I, one, thank Professor Hendricks for helping us see how to recontextualize the ministry of Jesus, but also it pushes us to really reorient ourselves with Scripture. That I think is highly necessary. As he talks about reading from below, you know, the reality is that some of us can only read from below because of where our own social location is, and so there's really one way of looking at it. But I think this notion of reorienting ourselves with Scripture, understanding what it looks like to have a different relationship with Scripture, And I think part of the reason why, as Professor Hendricks spoke of the tragedy of many of our churches and even the tragedy of his father's experience in the church, is because there has been, in many ways, a distorted or even dysfunctional relationship with Scripture, where Scripture replaces relationship with God. And so the marching orders comes by virtue of texts that can be manipulated by voices for their own personal agenda. And so I think this is part of the issue we must begin to thrust ourselves into. How do we reorient ourselves with Scripture in a way that does not become handicapping or disempowering, but empowers us to seek to be true, not Christians, but true followers of Jesus? And I love that point in the book, because I think the last thing we need now are more indoctrinated, self-aggrandizing Christians. But I'm convinced that we need more people who take Jesus and the gospel ministry seriously, and more churches who seek to follow in the footsteps of Jesus and not simply use Jesus as a tool to further oppress those who are trying to break free from oppression. And so I think that is critical. But then lastly, and I'll stop, I don't want to kill my 10 minutes. But I'm glad we have this company up here, because I also, as we begin to engage in conversation, I would really want to also push us to a conversation. My struggle as a pastor is that when I was in divinity school, and I was blessed, I had a mentor who passed away in 1995, but who challenged us. His name, and Professor Hendricks, I'm sure you may have heard of him, Fredrick Herzog. Was my mentor, was one of my professors, and a tremendous human being, period. And I appreciated Dr. Herzog over the years because of his willingness to engage the church differently. Dr. Herzog, in his last article before he died October 9th, 95, his article was entitled The New Birth of Conscience. And in my personal conversations with Dr. Herzog that preceded the writing of this article, he said something was radically wrong with theological education. He said the way theological education is done and the way we do theology is problematic. He said something that I had to get and write it down, but he said, why is theology blind? And what is theology's blindness? He said, for lack of interest in theology, theologians themselves are partly to blame. In our capitalist society, theology too often has become private enterprise, relegated to a limited few who simply engage in bantering between one another. We must abandon a theology of private self-consciousness and think more, not about God talk, but as he said, God walk. And God walk would be a fusion, again, to something I said earlier, fusion of our bodies with our words, and then truth would be established by that which we would be willing to lay our life on the line for. So that for Dr. Herzog, and I credit him tremendously, theology in some ways itself and religious study itself must be liberated from its own captivity to really capitalistic and a capitalistic ethos that is problematic. Another scholar who I was fond of, Swiss theologian Walter Hellenwerker, says scholarly theology is bankrupt not because its products are completely worthless, but because it cannot transport its products to where they are more needed than daily bread, and that is the church and society. So that as a student of theology and as a divinity school student, the dean at the time said that our task is to lead theologically, to lead the people to think theologically. And at some point, we must begin to not only raise the critiques of what is wrong with our churches and what is wrong with our country, but we must begin to show how do we translate these kinds of revelations by virtue of texts such as this or other enlightened professors. How do we become the translators so that people who come out of seminaries don't feel like they have to abandon what they learned to be effective in the church? Mm-hmm. And so to me, that is the real challenge. How do we help shape those who take the prophetic edge seriously? How do we help shape the next generation of public theologians in the church who seek to recontextualize Jesus and take the Jesus movement seriously? How do we empower another generation of persons who simply do not want to be part of a church, but want to be part of a movement? And so I think that is a challenge that is before us, but I thank Professor Hendricks for pushing us in that direction. Thank you.
Thank you.
Also want to thank Pastor for welcoming us here, and the esteemed conversation partners, and our author for creating a context not just to discuss this book in particular, but all of the issues that the book raises. In terms of celebrating the dimensions of the book that jumped out to me most immediately, I think many of our colleagues, both of you, and in the introductory comments have highlighted them. I just want to say at the beginning that it strikes me that one of the biggest strengths of the book is this remarkable capacity to take very clear social analysis and biblical study language and intersperse it with poetic language and stories and a kind of vivid quality to engagement that is hard to find in books today that are moving back and forth between those languages. I also am particularly struck in this book, as I was in your previous book, and this is a self-interested comment on my part, but the degree to which your experience as the president of a seminary, but also as a business person, gives a kind of pragmatic, grounded edge to the social analysis, always coming back to the question, not just generally speaking, what should our politics be, but more specifically, why do groups of people behave the way they do, and what does it take to change behavior and to create new kinds of social order? Those are the questions, not just of a theologian, but of an administrator. And that is a voice that is often completely absent from our discussions of theology and Bible. And more of that, I would hope, will come in the future. I found myself in reading this torn, struggling, stretched in the space between two communities. In your opening comments, I was reminded of the context in which I grew up, which was rural Oklahoma. And in the community where I was raised, a very mixed batch of people. Some arrived in Oklahoma, Lutherans from Pennsylvania. Some came on the Trail of Tears from the southeast. Others arrived along with Marcus Garvey in the hopes of carving out a space for a new life. And in the early settlements, there was this great populist aspiration grounded in scripture that led the people of Oklahoma to elect the first and really only socialist governor ever to be elected. It is now, in the context of that same community, the most right-wing state in terms of its voting patterns in the country. Time and again, if you want to know where the Tea Party is strong and where the right wing's moving, you go and look at the polls of what's happening in Oklahoma. Now that's a remarkable coincidence of language, and one of the complex dimensions of it is you could probably hear the same sermon in a church today that you heard 80 years ago when it was voting socialist. And it puts before us the question of how does this religious language work sometimes in ways that the same words produce different kinds of social effects. And I think that's a puzzling thing as a pastor to think about. What is the relationship between the actual words you're using and the context of the community in which it is enacted in terms of how we think about what we mean? The other place in which I live is Union Theological Seminary. One of the interesting things about Union is it's actually a place where there's absolutely nothing that isn't talked about. In fact, sometimes I wish we weren't talking about so many things. So it's an interesting way to think about the spectrum of conversations. But at the very time Oklahoma is going right wing and you see the collapse of the church pouring in the doors of Union are a new generation of young seminarians who are headed back into the church with grand aspirations for its revitalization. They do not come as seminary with aspirations to be in any way grand in terms of their social status. Nobody goes to seminary anymore because they want a big fancy job.
I don't know.
Well,
they hope for mega
churches. I mean, you think they hope? Yeah. Are there enough of them around though that it makes?
Make your point.
Okay.
That's a conversation.
You can argue about it.
We'll argue about it. But so I see this world springing to life in a church that's in a sense coming up through the cracks, a kind of organic movement that in some ways is being expressed in the streets of New York tonight. The question I would like to bring to us is what that is all about with regard to notions of hope. I would like to ask you a couple of questions that I think would be interesting for me to have a conversation with you about, perhaps for us to reflect on together. I was fascinated by the way in which you move back and forth between structural social analysis, economic systems, and the language of individual people's agency with respect to their own implication in the very systems that are killing them. And that seems to me to be a very deeply biblical theme, and one that stretches us at every moment to never collapse onto either side of that discussion. But in a way, I wish I had heard more about, and this is my own old-fashioned religion coming out, sin. And sin in the individual, prideful, inevitable cracking of the heart that happens as avarice controls our desires, and how that fits with a critique of capitalism. Connected to that is also a question of, there is hope in the book, but where does that hope spring from? And this is a question about how you understand who human beings are and what makes us hope and what makes us corrupt. And how do we account for that hope? It's all over the book, The features of who we are, I think that what's happening right now in our nation is a groaning for a kind of meaning and connection that has been lost, that's coming up out of the bowels of our lives, rather than from a well-constructed pulpit of our lives. And I'll end on this in terms of a question. The Jesus you describe is, in many ways, I had a wonderful church community that I grew up in, the Jesus that I was raised on. I learned this Jesus, I walked with this Jesus, in many ways, this Jesus that is in those spaces of marginalization was the theology that I was formed in the context of. And yet, I find myself today wondering about the radical revolutionary potential of a Jesus who is not just a revolutionary and not just a figure grounded in the logic of social justice, but a figure who is always on the other side of imaginative possibility, in a sense, always cracking our own preconceptions open and pushing us, and it's sometimes ethereal language, into spaces that might flip back on your own text and raise questions about the shape of the Jesus that is figured there. So it's this Jesus that's in the cloud, in a sense, and the kind of liberative potential that lives there.
Okay.
Thank you.
So we'll get a short response and then we'll open up for questions.
Well, thank you. I just want to try to take a moment to respond to, to each. I really appreciate my colleagues here. And I'll try to respond in order. Barbara Savage, by the way, who came all the way from Philadelphia to honor us with her presence, and who is just, her book is, your book, the title of it again is?
Your Spirits Walk Beside Us.
Your Spirits Walk Beside Us, extraordinary book. I've used it in my course a number of times, and so I'm really thankful to have you and appreciate your insights, Barbara. You talked about a certain return to the fundamentalism and in the best sense of basics, what it really says. And that's very interesting because what I've tried to do, even keeping in mind that everyone has their own preconceptions and their own, is that I've tried to deal with integrity what I believe the Bible really says in ethical terms and in moral terms. And I've tried to, in this book, I tried to deal with it in terms of spirituality, in terms of politics, in terms of economics. In terms of spirituality, there's an essay on gospel music. And the title is, I Am the Holy Dope Dealer. It comes from a quote from Kirk Franklin. It says, I am the holy dope dealer, and Jesus' rock is the drug I'm dealing, and it'll give you a high like you never had before. And I just found that a little bit problematic, because, you know, it's like he's saying, yeah, Karl Marx was right. Religion is the opiate of the people, you know, that'll just make them feel different but won't empower them to change anything. And so I spend a chapter looking at gospel music, its performance orientation, its early self-definition. You find the early gospel singers calling what they did clowning and trickeration. That's how they defined what they were doing early on. And, you know, folk call it spirit, call it getting the spirit, but they called it getting the spirit. They also called it clowning. They acknowledged that it was very performance oriented. And so I wanted to look at what that means when we take our power and our strength, our emotional power, and utilize it in service to or in reaction to performances. I'd like to talk about that a little bit more, but maybe we'll, and we have question and answer. But for me, gospel music, contemporary gospel music, has turned out to be very, very problematic, because if you do everything that these songs said, almost all of them, it'll change nothing in this world. Change the way you feel, and it's entertaining. Now, if we want to call it gospel entertainment, that's one thing. But if we want to call it gospel and act like we're calling the power of God to change the world, most gospel music doesn't even acknowledge the realities of the world. It doesn't talk about oppression at all. So how can we hope to change it if we don't even name it in our primary mode of expression? Also tried to deal with what the Bible really says in political and economic terms, because the religious right has hijacked all of the definitions. And when you hear folk talking about freedom is the main, is what our economic system should be about, rather than responsibility, when it talks about individuality rather than responsibility for our neighbors, it's like these folk on the religious right, no matter how religious they claim they are, they seem not to realize the Bible said, love your Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. So we have to get back to the fundamentals of that. And in order to do that, of course, is had to engage political conservatism, its principles, and really its economic principles on their own ground. You know, folk, we remember trickle-down economics, right? Reagan and his trickle-down economics. You might have heard the name of Milton Friedman thrown around, and Austrian economics that Ron Paul's throwing around. Not only are these not good for the average people, they are demonically anti-Bible. Demonic because they are counter to the very basis of the biblical message, but they're this opposite of the biblical message is given to us in the name of the biblical message. To me, that's demonic. And it's demonic also because it has so many people in its thrall. So we have poor folk who are going to, who would suffer from Herman Cain's 999, for instance, who are supporting Herman Cain's 999. That's sad and that's sick, and Jesus would have a big problem with that. And also politically, political conservatism, the basis of it is preserving power and privilege where it is, conserving power and privilege where it is, basically. That's a nutshell definition. And so that's getting back to the basics of the and the fundamentals of Jesus. So Barbara, I really thank you for raising that, because that's really what I tried to do, to
thank
look
you.
At. In terms of Pastor Waldron, Pastor Waldron, you know, as you talk about the church and its importance, you know, I did not, I mean, I thank you for talking about that and about trying to recontextualize the teachings of Jesus, because really Jesus did say, follow me. He didn't say, praise me, to praise God. Didn't say, worship me, to worship God. He said, love me, admire me, but follow me. And that implies ethical action. You can only follow, you follow deeds. You don't follow beliefs. You can't follow that. You can hold that, but you can't follow that. He calls, so I'm trying to lift up what it means to follow Jesus in social and economic and political terms. And today we need to talk about policy. What does that mean? It's policies that run our lives and that are distorting our lives. And we have people running government who are purveying policies in distorted ways to us that can crush our coming generations. And it's time that we start really dealing with particular policies. For instance, if you sign an anti-tax pledge, you'll never raise taxes, that's saying, and then claim you are a person of faith, that's ridiculous, because what you're saying is, no matter who starves, no matter how much the children of God need, I'm not going to respond to that. I'm going to hold to my ideological pledge. That is, speak of sin, that's a sin. And that is more than individual sin, because you're hurting many people. And so we have to start questioning these things. We have to start questioning folks who want to cut the safety net from under us, and claim that what they're trying to do is save the economy. They weren't worried about any deficit when the previous president was running up deficits. In fact, the previous vice president said deficits don't matter. He said that out of his mouth, and nobody said a word. Now, all of a sudden, when there's someone trying to help the people who really need help, this is what they're saying. Well, we have to push back on that and deconstruct that and meet them on their own ground. And I appreciate Pastor Warren talking about the importance of trying to lead theologically. I think that's something I've tried to do, and I think it's crucial for all of us try to do, to lead folk back to the fundamentals that Dr. Savage talked about. And I know that you're trying to do that here in your church. I hear it all the time from your parishioners that are my students, and I'm thankful for it. And so thank you, Pastor Waldron, for your witness and for your remarks. And Dr. Serene Jones, whom I'm sort of feeling sour grapes about, because she has Cornell West in her school and not mine, but I'm thankful just to have him back in the neighborhood. He's a friend and was an important professor of mine in graduate school. Different words having different social effects. The same words having different social effects, rather. And that is really our fight here, because we're not fighting against flesh and blood. We need to stop, ad hominem attacks. We don't care about putting people down, but we are fighting about principalities, against principalities and powers. They want us, to fight against flesh and blood. They're always trying to point out, Obama's doing this wrong, and this one doing that wrong, be angry with them. But we must be concerned about the systems that are trying to take away what we have, and that if we let them go, will result in greater disparities of poverty and wealth in this nation. And the way they're doing it is by distorting the message of the gospel. Jesus talked about the poor more than anything else other than God. You don't hear these folk talking about poor folk at all. They talk about the middle class, but their policies aren't even worried about the middle class, much less poor folk. They turned the gospel, the biblical prophetic message, on its head, in that the prophets railed against systems that corrupt, that exploited and oppressed people's lives. These people make it a sign of godliness to support these systems. They make it a god out of patriotism. And if you do not put the patriotism as they define it first, which is an idol, then they claim that you're not that we're not respecting God or following God, or that we're not believing, that we're not Christians. We have to turn the table. We have to say, Grover Norquist, you and your no tax pledge, you got to prove to us, you have to prove to us that you're Christian or that you're a person of biblical faith, because you ain't shown it so far. Newt Gingrich, Lord, no, we don't need any comment. Herman Cain, who gave a sermon that said it was a liberal court that crucified a conservative Jesus. Now, I know that he's about the most backward thing we've seen on the political scene in a while, but we still must push back against these things because there are people who believe them. So yes, same words are used differently, but we have to reclaim them, and we have to reclaim the basic egalitarianism of the biblical message, which says that all God's people have the right to be all right. Everyone's supposed to have the same access to the tree of life. Everyone's supposed to have the same access to opportunity, to the same. And Jesus said it in Matthew 25. He said, those who are going to be who are going to go to hell, this is the only really judgment he gave where you're going to go to hell, are those who do not clothe the hungry, clothe the naked and feed the hungry, as you have not done it to the least of these, you have not done it to me. We have to reclaim that and reassert that as the basis of the gospel. He said, the Spirit of the Lord's upon me because he's anointed me to preach good news to the poor, which is about changing the structures that make and keep people poor so there'll be no poor. We must reclaim that and say, this is what it means to be a Christian politician, a Christian policymaker, and reclaim that ground. And lastly, it means that we must reclaim our agency and our responsibility. And as Pastor Mike, I like to say that Pastor Mike said it, we must reclaim what it means to be followers. He didn't say, puff yourself up, talk about I'm Christian, or I'm saved, sanctified, and washed in blood of Jesus. He didn't say that. He said, be a follower. And that means to look at what his path was. And you follow it. And Chris Watson is in my Mark seminar this semester. And we look at, in Mark, it's so clear that what Jesus is doing, he's going everywhere trying to raise people's consciousness, pushing back against oppression, pushing back against exploitation, pushing back against bogus definitions. And that is the model we're getting of what it means to be a follower, and ultimately, I guess we'd say to be a Christian if you want to go that far. I don't even know if we need to name ourselves anything. I think we need to stop naming ourselves and start showing who we are. So I thank you for your comments. These are my responses, my thoughts that come to mind, and I hope we can have some conversation before we open for questions.
Okay. So we're going to open up for questions. There are mics on each side of the aisle. So please come up with a question. In the meantime, Professor Hendricks, you started off with some comments about contemporary gospel music. And what I want you to do is talk a little bit more about that. Because when you were making those comments, I was wondering, well, hasn't gospel music pretty much, based on your critique, have always sort of been not focused enough, always focused on the individual and not on sort of social change? And could one also provide the same critique about
the spirituals?
Mm-hmm. Let me say quickly. First off, I grew up on spirituals. I grew up on the Soul Stirrers, and the old guy, Sister Rosetta Thorpe, who was quite a performer on a guitar. But I grew up on the spirituals. I love deeply sincere and deeply felt spirituals. But we have a difference between deeply felt gospels music. And I also grew up on the spirituals, of course, but we have a difference between the spirituals and the gospels. The spirituals talked about, they have what we call an eschatology of justice. The spirituals talked about the Exodus, how the Hebrew children were liberated from Pharaoh, and talked about the Daniel in the lion's den, how he was rescued. And it was empowering. Folk had coded messages. They were singing about, I'll see you over yonder, when they really meant, we leave in the night to be free. And so the spirituals had this eschatology of justice that expected justice in this world and tried to empower people to hold on and to resist oppression for justice in this world. Those were the spirituals. The gospel music spirituals were born in the rural precincts. Gospel music was essentially born in the urban areas. And it was at a time when black folks were just beaten down terribly, at a time when Africans and pygmies in particular were put in cages at the World's Fair and exhibited like animals. A time when soldiers coming back from World War I were attacked and bloodied and beaten and lynched in the streets, black soldiers, because they dared to wear a uniform to defend the country that would not even grant them rights. And so when Thomas Dorsey pushed with gospel music, he said it himself. Look, it wasn't to bring them no bad news, it was to bring good news, to remind people of good things. All right, good. What it means first then is that gospel music was not about inspiring people to fight or to struggle to resist. It was about, and listen to the words, leave it to Jesus. I mean, which really is pretty much the subtext there. It says that, well, things have gotten so bad and that we really can't, they don't see how we're strong enough to do it, so we call on Jesus or we leave it to Jesus. What we do in the meantime is praise his holy name. I'm not knocking gospel music, but I'm saying that's its basis. And then what we saw was the trajectory of this very intense performance orientation, which became really performance-focused to a large degree.
When did that happen?
It happened early on, in the 40s, in the 50s. I told you, the R.H. Harris said, shoot, all this stuff y'all talking about James Brown doing, this hip-slapping stuff James Brown was doing, I was doing years ago. And we had Professor Alex Bradford, for instance, who won commentator called the Little Richard of gospel music, who jumped all over the place. We had Clara Ward singers. They came out in wigs this high and all matching outfits, and they danced all over the place. We're talking about in the 50s. And now these days we see folk come out with these great leather suits with four or five hip-hop dancers around them, and they jump all around and try to act like this is about God. I'm sure God's in there somewhere, but it really is about, entertaining the people. So there's nothing wrong with that, if we call it that. But what I'm saying, that it's a squandered opportunity, because if we were able to just in put into the music some different lyrics, some lyrics maybe we got from the spirituals, that and use that power to empower folk to go out and change the world, it would make such a big difference, rather than being like Kirk Frickson says, being just dope, which makes people feel different, but it doesn't make them act any differently or do anything different in the world except respond to those emotions. So that's one of the essays in the book.
You have a follow-up to his? Okay.
Yeah. I guess, I'm in no way an apologist for contemporary gospel music. I grew up United Methodist Church, hymns and anthems. but I would say the critique you raise of contemporary gospel music, I don't know if I need contemporary gospel music right now to be a clarion call to prophetic social justice. I think that, and I'll follow up with a couple of comments. One, when the comparison between contemporary gospel music and the spirituals, I think you have to do what you suggest in the book, which is always maintain social location. Those codified songs that were sung in a context where they had no other vehicle to voice their concerns. So that the codification of the singing became a way to communicate in a way that from the outside seemed passive, but internally they understood of the what was being said in a time where there's no real vehicle to voice their frustration. Mm-hmm. Now, I'm gonna jump, this is very, I'm gonna try to quit with it, but in the context where the vehicles are available, I don't know if the music needs to do the same thing. Because I'm in a place where I don't know now if Kirk Franklin needs to have a justice-oriented eschatology. I need the preacher to have that in the pulpit so that as the trumpet, as the scriptures say, if the trumpet makes an uncertain sound, who will prepare the people for battle? I view the proclaimer as that trumpet, as the one who must rally the troops. Jesus did not have a praise team. So therefore, for me, music is a tool, but it is not the thing that ignites the kind of prophetic social engagement that I think will lead to the transformation of so many in our country. The pronouncements from that pulpit, the proclaimers, the preachers, those people who are given the task to give voice to the struggle as you're doing in this text, have that task. And then I don't want to also, and again, I'm not a defender of Kirk Franklin, I got issues with Kirk too, but I would also keep that in context. Kirk Franklin is an entertainer. Exactly. And an entertainer exactly. knows his or her audience. That quote of Kirk Franklin does not come in an interview in Theology Today. It comes in an interview with Vibe magazine. Kirk knows who he's talking to and who's reading this book, or the magazine, in the language of that context. And so even, I'm not saying it's the right thing to do, but I think he's speaking in a way, and as you noted in your book, for the audience that he's dealing with, more hip-hop, urban, young, contemporary. But I don't know if Kurt has in his mind Karl Marx, if Kurt know who Karl Marx is, I don't know. But what I would say is that here's my struggle, I guess, as I looked at the piece on the critique on gospel music, because you talked about the performance orientation of contemporary gospel music, but the performance culture seems to permeate not just contemporary music, but even in the academy, though, where there are intellectual performers and we who market their lyricism.
Yeah, right.
And so exactly. So the performance orientation is not just in gospel music, it is a part of the larger culture that is consumed with performance and image. Mm-hmm. And so I appreciate, because at least Kirk say he's an entertainer. Mm-hmm. There are those who mask as theologians, preachers, scholars who won't say that they're entertaining. Mm-hmm. So I appreciate that. The other piece is, you said one thing you said is that it changes the way you feel. But I'm always amazed, and by the way, let me say, we use your book, Politics of Jesus, here at the church, too, right? So I got to say that. We use that book here. But I'm always amazed when I hear, I for one, come out of a school where social justice was preached to us consistently. I mean, you at Morehouse, you're going to be a Morehouse man. You're a leader for social change.
I mean, what happened for Kane, though, man?
Well, Kane, we, you know what's funny? I got to say this. You know, Morehouse put out a disclaimer about Kane. they just said he was a graduate. That's it. But
not a Morehouse man.
Yeah, he didn't say he was a Morehouse. He's a graduate of Morehouse. But but I... I one of the things that captures me about your writings and also about this Jesus movement is that I do think that Jesus' movement, among any things, and Dr. Jones kind of pushes us to that place, seeks to affirm the personhood of human beings. It is a both and. There is not just the notion of radically changing the structures that keep people poor, but it also, because if you change the structures that keep people poor, but then the poor people don't know how to find value in their being, then it is a waste of time. Because then you no longer need the structures. The poor person will create structures that reinforce their inferiority if they're not affirmed and their personhood is not affirmed. So in Jesus' work, because I think it's interesting that Jesus is, especially when you talk about Mark, that Jesus's travels don't go to Rome. Which means that this transformation of the structures is taking place within a particular context, and he is not trying to change the policies of Rome. He's trying to change the mindset of the people in Galilee so that no matter what the policy says, they know how to affirm themselves as human beings. So I'm not saying that it's an either or. I think it's a both and. I think if you take Jesus seriously, you do come to a place where you must really challenge the structures that reinforce inequalities and poverty and injustice. But at the same time, I don't want to underestimate the value of parts of gospel music that pushes people to a place to affirm themselves not only as human beings, but human beings in relationship to God. Because that is where their value and dignity comes from.
Right, in that God relationship.
So I appreciate now again a lot of the performance and the gospel is sometimes gets carried away, but I do want us to keep that in mind. There's a place for the affirmation of personhood via gospel music.
Absolutely.
Can I split the difference here on that? Because I think it's a really interesting little debate that's going on here. But I think it is important to remember that part of the problem with the critique of Kurt Franklin and part of is that not just him, there's a tremendous amount of access and influence that comes with his role as an entertainer. And so the question might be, what responsibility does he have? But I think more importantly than that is, who is his counterpart? That is, if we don't like Kurt Franklin's message as an entertainer, is there somebody out there who's doing contemporary religious music, who's actually saying some of what we're saying up here tonight, who actually is talking about following Jesus, that the message is actually, so it's, nobody's beating up on Kurt Franklin. It's like, where are the other voices? Because if you have, you know, alternatives and you just don't buy Kurt Franklin, you don't go to that concert, you go and you listen to whoever, but it's the dearth of other voices, I think, that also is the problem. In popular culture and certainly something that has a great deal of both economic and social access or social capital.
Let me just say, I appreciate these comments very much. And the empath is very important. Let me what's the song, Pharaoh, that tears us up every time we hear it? By Kirk Franklin? The reason why we sing?
Is that,
what's it called? Kirk Franklin song.
Silver and gold.
Is it silver and gold? It's the reason. Silver and gold. That's the reason why we sing. Anyway, the song is, man, that song, I can't hear it without getting just moved, you know, without being moved. I mean, there is the empathic, you know, the empathy, the nurturance that we find in gospel, so much gospel music, is very important. I don't knock that at all. I grew up on gospel music. It was less concerned. I found it more nurturing than the orientation now. But for me, there are a couple questions, and that is not, the question is not what gospel music does not proclaim, because you can nurture people and support their sense of themselves and give them hope without making a prophetic proclamation. I mean, you can't, often there's just not enough room to do both anyway. The question for me is not what it doesn't proclaim, but that it often distracts. It is a distraction sometimes. It makes claims of being about being spirit-led when often it's merely just spirit-ted, and we have, and it has people, it works folk up without necessarily empowering. Now that's entertainment, and I love to be entertainment too, but entertained too. But we must call that. So don't get me wrong, I'm not down on gospel music. I got a bunch of gospel music, you know. I am from the black church. I didn't grow up United Methodist. I grew up Baptist, you know. I grew up not just folks shouting, but falling on top of me, man. I got hurt as a child. people falling on top of me. And the other question though was, what is it that these folk are modeling then? What does this performance orientation model that is empowering to people? Now if we say I'm a gospel entertainer, that's then fine, I'm enjoying you. But if you want to present yourself as you the holy, you're holy and you present the word of God and you represent the word of God to people, then I gotta ask, what is it you're modeling to folk that's going to help them change their, that's going to help them understand what's going on around them and not just what's going on inside of them? So when you mention Jesus, how Jesus, you're right, Jesus wasn't just concerned about the structural, but he realized that it was the structural that was distorting people's lives so greatly. And that is what, I know those are kinds of things you talk about here, but that's also what's not being talked about in the music that's got more of our people's attention than anything than maybe hip-hop music. And so they go and they sing, they go to shows, and look at black folk. We still in the same shape that we in. But, you know, we have church, we have fun, we go in and we jump, you know what I'm saying? We gotta model something different. That's my critique, not that I dislike it, but that it presents a model that is sometimes null and void, and it distracts people's power often from more from the kinds of things that Jesus also told us to engage in. So if we follow everything it says, we would, very few of us would be following the kinds of prophetic things that Jesus told us to do to change the world. That's what I'm talking about. So we'll be talking about kingdom building as building churches rather than making this God's kingdom of justice on earth for all people.
Okay. Is there a question?
Yes, I had a question. My name is Bill Burke. I'm a former student of Dr. Hendricks, and I enjoyed your book so far. And my question is concerning gospel music, how you mentioned in the text how the spirituals represented we, the group, and how gospel music represents the individual. Mm. And at the time of the spirituals in chattel slavery, African Americans are on the same economic platform, really at zero. Mm. And now we see African Americans at different platforms, economically speaking. Do you see that's possible, that spirituals can become the norm or the voice of a group of people?
Spirituals or gospel?
Gospel, excuse me.
Can become the norm of?
As it did in the early days, as you describe in the book, during chattel slavery. Where speaking as the group and you identify gospel music as speaking for the individual.
Yeah, I think we're talking about the relationship between Christ and culture, or religion and culture, right? And that gospel music, like everything else, like every other social formation, can often reflect the time and the setting that it's in. But you made an important point. Spirituals were a communally constructed music. They came out of the community. They didn't have discrete authors. They often didn't have soloists. And anybody from the South know you go down there and the old folks still do it the old way. They call it moaning. They'd hum, and somebody would start, and they all come in and they sing it together. Gospel music is though different. Gospel music is commodified. Because Dorsey began copywriting his songs, songs were identified with particular people rather than expressions of organic communities. So I'm not saying that's wrong, it's just a sign of the time, but it does lack that communal aspect, which was not performative in the same sense. You know, now it's performed by saying and performed by particular people, and we have to notice that too often congregations are not congregations, they're audiences. They audit, they listen, they hear, they don't participate. So, I mean, that's, I hope I'm getting nearer answer for you. I'm thinking that the gospel music, though, with its specialization, now we have soloists and all that. You know, I tried to show in the essay that the development of that mirrored the development of the of industrialism, industrial capitalism, and the music, you know, mirrored the growth of the assembly line where you have the specialization and everything, and folk didn't have that before.
I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
I do agree that that should be that should still be the spirit, but that was my question, is it possible?
Communal spirit again.
Yeah, that folks are in different economic stations.
Can it act as a bridge?
Yeah, no, can that be heard again? Is it possible?
The communal nature.
Yeah, of the spirituals.
I think it could if we reproclaimed the message of Jesus. Jesus had a communal message. You know, the Hebrew Bible doesn't have a word for individual. It's am. The word's am, people. It doesn't acknowledge. So salvation, and you raise an important point. As long as we keep talking about I'm looking for my salvation, rather than we're looking for the salvation of the people, like in the Hebrew Bible, like Simeon in the temple in Luke, where he's sitting around the temple waiting for the salvation. The people reminded me of the old race men in the barbershop when I was growing up, waiting for the salvation of the Negro, as they call it. And Martin Luther King, they'd say, was helping to bring the salvation. You know, if we reclaimed that, yes, if churches reclaimed that communalism, I think reclaimed Jesus, the message of Jesus, I think we could see that again. I think that's the only thing that's going to save us. Economics is egalitarianism, socially is egalitarianism, and that's the message of Jesus. Everybody as one, as a people, we strive to the salvation of the people, of the society, of the world, and not just, I want to get mine, which of course is what prosperity
I agree. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Thank
you.
Let me just say that so that what you would be calling for in terms of music is the corollary to neo-soul, which was a casting back and a coming forward. So what you really want is a neo-spiritual.
Oh, Lord. Go ahead, girl.
I like how you put that, Mark. The neo.
You heard me. I made that word up. She got it from me, right?
The neo-spiritual, but it goes back, I think, what you just said, it goes back to what I tried to say earlier, is that his question asks, can it become that? Can contemporary gospel, you know, take on that communal ethos? Can it ever be that neo-spiritual, you know? And you hit it on the head. You said it could be if we reproclaim the message of Jesus, which that means that the next Kirk Franklin, the only way we don't recreate that depends on where that next man or woman is sitting every Sunday.
That's right.
That's right.
And what they're hearing.
Yeah, that's right.
So that it goes back to the message of the man or woman who proclaims. If there's inconsistency from the proclaimer, you see, because Kurt Frankel's a member of somebody church, and heard things that pushed him in a particular direction. I put the burden on people like myself,
amen,
not on Kurt Franklin. Amen. I want to teach Kurt Franklin how to reclaim or really follow the footsteps of Jesus and not be intoxicated by consumer culture to make money in Jesus' name.
And we scholars have to play that role too. We can't just be ivory tower.
Well, I'm gonna stop.
There you go. No, you're right.
Okay, we're gonna go to a question.
Good evening, praise the Lord. So I have a couple little things to say. I know we mentioned briefly about what's going on tonight in the city in reference to all of these
occupy.
Yeah, they're all around. I don't want to say boycotting, but they're protesting. And I was really not aware, but what turned me off with them is that they said about 2 weeks ago that they decided to go gourmet because the homeless were coming in the park begging them for meals. Wow. So that could definitely not be anything like Jesus. And I said, well, they're fighting a fight, and it's supposed to be equality, but the homeless don't even get the homeless people. They just get the homeless. So that totally disconnected me from that fight. Because, and then to think that the homeless are not going to eat gourmet. If you're hungry, you're going to eat whatever they have. So I don't know why they thought that that would change anything. But it's just such a disconnection from you fighting that fight, but you're not concerned with those people over there. In terms of the music and growing up in the church and being one of those people, and I know I'm not alone, where you definitely was going to church on Sunday, or you must be sick in bed, because you wasn't going to play outside, you wasn't doing any of those things. And I think that at a certain age, you get your independence and you decide that you don't have to do that, so you don't. And I could never identify with songs like Amazing Grace or I'm Going Up to Yonder when I was my daughter's age, 12. And I often wonder if I would have had Mary, Mary, I'm Walking, or It's the God in Me. Would I have been able to just sit there and listen to that and understand it? Some people say, walking takes too long. Oh, okay. They're talking about the walk with Jesus. So I kind of look at it differently. I had a family function full of teenagers, and I discovered It's the God in Me when it first came out, and I played it. My siblings can bear witness to that, and they lost their mind. What is that? I'm hip. Must be hip, because they like this song. And then they started listening to the music, and then before you know it, they started singing the song. And then every now and then you would hear them singing it, because it's about the music. To us, it's the music. But to them, it's the music and the words. When you talk about this song about the dope with Kirk Franklin, I wonder if a drug dealer that heard that, because he would be able to identify with that, especially if you start talking about how you cutting it up, slicing it, and doing all of that. He would be able to identify with that. But with him listening to that, what change would that make within him? We really don't know. So sometimes when we talk about traditional churches, I surely know that I never believed it when they told me in the Baptist church that I grew up in, come as you are. Just don't come in jeans. Just don't come with a skirt that fits you a little bit too big.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Just don't come this way or that way, but come as you are. When you're able to be blessed with a church or a house of God that offers you contemporary and tradition, you've been blessed to understand that, no, they really mean come as you are. And they mean it on an external and an internal. Okay. Because if you do that, you'll be changed. And then at some point, you may come a little differently on the external. Because you get around some folk. I know you want to cut me off for just one second. You get around some folk, and you'll start feeling comfortable, and you'll start being able to understand the word. And you'll start mimicking, you'll start seeing people, and things will change for you. And maybe you couldn't afford that suit, but you will at some point. So we gotta be very careful about how we talk about traditional and how we talk about contemporary. One second.
I'm not trying to cut you off. I want to respond.
Okay.
But
go ahead. Respond.
Oh, you're not finished?
No, but I'm
oh, okay.
I'm a human, I'm a director for a program, an apartment program. So I'm a human service professional.
Uh-huh.
But in my profession, a lot of us treat the people that we work with the most inhumane.
Yeah.
But we are human service representatives.
Mm-hmm.
And I take it very seriously when I come in here, my pastor or my first lady, or you know, if I'm sitting down talking to somebody and they talk about how you got to represent all the time, and how I almost am hesitating to speak to my staff or the consumers that we work with about Jesus, because that's not really what our agency said. Oh, you can't do it. But you, I'm trying to assist you in the process of restructuring and changing your life. It ain't gonna happen without him. So I don't know how to not mention him or ask you to, you know, I'm gonna pray for you. Or, you know, I can't invite you to my church. I can't tell you to read the Bible. I can't give you no scriptures. I'm afraid to say God bless you around certain administrators.
When you talk about administrators,
because I'm an administrator. So when we talk about justice and politics and tradition and all of this stuff, we all got to really get together. We need a bigger panel than this. We need OMH and DHS and DM. We need a whole lot of folk in here. Because what it is when we was talking about God in school, things were different. They don't pray. They don't do none of that. You can't mention Jesus in there either.
Okay. Yeah.
I'ma go. I just wanted to say that.
Oh no, thank you. No, thank you, thank you. Well, you made some very good points, and yes, you took time to make sure it was clear what you were saying, and I think that's important. You know, for me, it comes down to two things when it comes to gospel. Well, the gospel music comes down to this. I think the prior question is, what does Jesus call us to do? What is the nature of Jesus' message? And then the question is this, that, the other gospel music, this book, that book, whatever it is it consistent with what he calls us to do? Now, the question I don't think is not whether it captures anyone's attention, because a lot of things can capture people's attention. And it doesn't, and my question always is, once we get them in, the question is what do they understand themselves as being called to? And what does it mean to them in terms of what they're going to do from that point? You know, I've always been very careful when I've spoken to churches, you know, and preached to churches, and they say, open the doors of the church. I don't do that at every church, because there's some churches that I'm not sure what I'm calling people to do when you open the doors of the church. And so I'm careful about that. I think that in terms of you talk about how hard it is to call to bring Jesus to people in situations where you know would make a difference, and I know what you're talking about. But I think that can all be cleared up with this, that Jesus was not concerned about Jesus. Jesus was concerned about Jesus' teachings. And Jesus' teachings can be taught, emulated, lived without mentioning Jesus' name, and I can't see any evidence in the Bible that Jesus would be upset about it. And in fact, I offer this, I might get in trouble, but you know, it's too often that what's been evolved around Jesus in some places around the country, and we've seen on TV at times, is something that's almost like a personality cult around Jesus, which is just concerned about Jesus' personality, which we don't really know except through the gospel, but less concerned with what Jesus said and what Jesus did and what Jesus modeled. And I think that's really our challenge. What is it that he's calling us to do, and what did he model for us in every aspect of life? And there's still so much to unpack in that. That's why these conversations are so very, very important for all of us. I'm learning from them, and I hope we all are too. Thank you.
First, I would like to welcome you all here to First Corinthian Baptist Church.
Thank you, thank you.
But I would like to say, when you spoke about, again, with Kurt Franklin, as a person who was in recovery, I was at a club one night, and the record Stomp came on, and a person said, why would you play that gospel music in here? And I looked at them and said, what you gonna do, leave him outside? So that being said, you know, like wherever you are, I believe that when he said, go. This is what Jesus said. He said, go and to teach the gospel, teach the good news, what he, that's the model that we're supposed to do. We're supposed to model the things that he did. He loved everyone. He said to take care of the least of these, those things. So when it comes to a Kurt Franklin song or any gospel song, like some people find it difficult to come into a church for the reason that she quoted, you come as you are, but don't wear jeans, or you can't wear hiked up skirts, or because you have to understand, you have people who are out there in the nights who have nothing but skirts up to their, you know, to their derriere, and they can't afford these things, but they know that there's something that's missing in their lives. So when they give their lives, when they began the journey of accepting Christ as their personal Lord and Savior, they come as they are. And that's what I did. I walked in these doors rugged, and I was just messed up. But I know that God, you know, helped to put things in me to make me a better person, who I am, who he called me to be. That being said, I don't think it's so much of the music, because what you need is someone to teach you the word so that you can go out and... Don't get it twisted. We got a powerful pastor and the Reverend Lakeisha. We have two powerful pastors here in this church. It's one teach the youth. And I think it's wonderful that we have someone where we can look at the Bible for ourselves now, because back in the time that you're referring to, those people weren't taught. They didn't read the Bible. They was told what the Bible said. So they've been misinformed, they've been hoodwinked and bamboozled. So I just want to say, I love the fact that you are all here so that you can get an understanding of where I'm coming from, because this community is in need of a refresher of the new word, the word. This is new. This is because the Bible has been out for 2,000 years. This is the first time I ever read the Bible. Okay, and I'm 53 years old, and to really get a better understanding of what God is trying to say to me, we have someone who has a man with integrity, and a sister too, my sister Reverend Lakeisha, I ain't gonna leave you out, you know I'm gonna holler you out. But I just wanna say how that is important that we have someone who really is steeped in the Lord. Like, the records is fine, because you gotta get in where you fit in. If this is where you are, if I'm at the after hours spot and I hear Stomp, then I'm gonna get my praise on in the after hours spot. Because I'm gonna tell you, I was talking to him in there too. I might have been down, but I was not out. And he, you know, one day I just came home because I was really tired. And I asked him, I said, if you just give me one more chance, after I've said it a zillion times, but I said, if you give me one more chance, I'm gonna learn to love you. You know, because I needed him in my life. I need God. And God is with me today. His spirit rests in me. And in me, he finds favor.
Okay. All right. All right. I feel like I'm in church now. Right? I appreciate the personal testimonies, but we really do want to keep it to the questions for the panel.
I don't necessarily have no questions, and I'm not going to go forward with the gospel and the music per se. I'm really here like to speak on the youth behalf, even though, you know, I got some aids to me. But to bring some light and some sense to what's really going on the avenues outside of what's going on at FCBC, it's a culture of youth who believe that nobody's really coming to get us, and we already in the loop. In the loop meaning that as long as it's a good 30 to 40 people who know your name going left to right of your building, you are right. And with being a right, if somebody tries to question you're a right, then you need to be an extremist. So now with that being said, if a person like Kirk Franklin is gonna take the time to quote unquote try to get in tune with that person, and that's the best effort that he did, people like you gotta use that tool or as far as he came and take it the rest of the way. Like, the biggest issue right now is the criticism. Like, so many people take time to criticize no matter what level you're on, nobody's getting focused, so we all struggling. Like, the reality of America is, the higher your tax bracket, the more control you have over your life. My reality is, the more in tune with your life, the longer you're going to live, and the more chances you are to see success or the American dream for what it's worth. Now, ironically, I got to speak on the music for you to get my point for what it's worth. I grew up with a grandmother who would sing, I don't even know what type of gospel grandma would sing. Word, right? And then I grew up with some gospel that I was forced to really get in tune with because the same grandmother who sung her gospel sent me to church to learn my own. Now, I took a lot of years off from church. It may be somebody in here who think they know me. They don't know me because they don't know how well I know Jesus. Like, nobody will never know you until you know yourself, until you can confirm that you know Jesus in the world of America. Because it's so many politics that really smother the spiritual that you fight through the flesh. You out of tune with the whack of where you're going after this world anyway. It's like we all chasing something that you can get and still lose, and then you don't know whether you're going to heaven or not. So it's like, who gonna take the time to learn every avenue of life and then try to reach them all at the end of the race? Like, people's mad that somebody's reaching out to the dope boy and somebody else reaching out to the preppy boy, but we all supposed to know Jesus. Who's gonna learn how to coordinate them all, like the graphs that they teach us in school that don't really mean nothing if you broke? Like, you learn about these graphs in the fourth grade, but if you can't get to no money to work the graph, you learned that for no reason, supposedly. But moving forward, like, who's gonna take these coordinates and put them together and show the picture of Jesus Christ? Or just keep talking about how they understand this diagonal angle, but they're not making it right. Like, I really don't understand. So, like, now, moving forward to the lady point about the power of promotion. If people learned how to take the power of God and commercialize it, like how they do with truth, and they bring cancer to you live, they don't stop, like, whether you want to see it or not, you see the power of cigarettes. If people learned how to do that with the word of God, that can make a change. Because if you see that it's real, if you stop dealing with the politics and you see that, yeah, the same person, if you hop the train and didn't have to go through the system that we know, what's his name, Raymond Kelly, have set up for you to go through, that's God on your side, because it's that easy. Like, people come at their house thinking they just going to the store and never go back home, that I know. So when we can unify Jesus in every single struggle, it can work. But people who just criticize in one lane of trying to make that image, we're going to lose forever and a day.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Let me just respond real quick.
Quick response, yeah, because, and then the last question.
Because
here,
this is not all. I mean, there's much more in the book than gospel music. And, you know, talking about what's going to put us forward as a people too. It's not just about criticism. We have to try to critically understand. We have to really engage these questions. And it's not about the putting folk down. It's about, you know, looking at them critically together. And we can come out the same place, but we have to engage them. We have to be willing to question them and engage them. And so, brother, you're talking about bringing the coordinates together. Yeah, we have to bring them together. But one thing that Jesus modeled for us is that he asked hard questions. And he was willing to engage things that people weren't willing to engage quite often, you know, because they were afraid they're going to be seen as being critical and all that. I have a responsibility. I've learned some things. I have a responsibility, just like you've learned some things, to raise these points. Now, we'll come out together if we're sincere, but if we're talking about Jesus, then we're not just talking about what makes us feel good or what buttresses where we are. I just wanted to raise that point. So I hope that we talk about some other things too, you know, because no one here is anti-church. I was president of a theological seminary that trained ministers. I grew up in the church. I'm ordained in the Amy Church. We're talking about looking at the Bible. We're not talking about fighting over it. You know, we're talking about engaging. We're not going to be loggerheads here.
Okay. Quick question.
And then we're going to.
Yesterday, Obery and I had an engagement about the gospel singing. And I'm a gospel singer. So at first, I was like, what is he talking about? But in some areas, I said to him, you are absolutely right in where we have allowed some of the music to go. We have made it competitive. A competition more than we have in some areas made it where Jesus is being moved in it. So I want you to know that it made me take a critical look at it and say he's absolutely right. I remember in the church back in the 70s and 80s where it was when we sang music and I'm an MC, so I do a lot of gospel competitions and a lot of different things, and I've seen where it changed, where as a gospel singer, I loved the music and loved going to where sometime I'm like, is it over yet? And so what I would like to see for us to be able to do is to be mindful of what did Jesus do and say and teach? Because I believe we have gotten away from that. And I'm also a pastor, but I was at a place that I was sick of the church. And I was sick of the church because of the antics. And I remember sometime we would sing the gospel music in the church, and it really wasn't going anywhere. But when we got outside in the public arena, it was more accepted. And so I would like us to, the church, and what the question I want to ask is, we are hearing these things, how do we today begin to think of these things critically and then be able to try to come back and to recapture?
Yeah.
Because the church is dying, and we need to be real with that. There are some churches that are really prospering, but there are churches that are dying because people don't want to be there. So how do we take all those different things now?
Yeah.
And we've heard the critiques. We're hearing the critiques.
Okay.
Now how do we put it all together?
Yeah, how do we bring it all together? Good question. And no, I appreciate that. And, you know, I will say this. First off, the way that I ended that essay, I thought I just gave it a thumbnail, and I misportrayed it, I think. But, you know, gospel music is so deeply important to American culture and to black culture and black church. How do we bring it together? I would not, you know, what I'd love to do, and what you all are pointing out, is that we need to be sitting down with Kirk Franklin, the gospel singers. We need to sit down and talk about, and inform and share with one another, and sit down and say, look, I really dig what you're doing with this, but I think it could empower people a little more if you did that. And they might say, well, you know, this is where our focus is and on back and forth. But, you know, to sit down together and inform one another, can you imagine Kirk Franklin with his power, his great power? If Kirk Franklin, or not just Kirk Franklin, but any of these powerful gospel singers were to say, well, I'm gonna, at this next step in my career, I'm gonna use some of this power to raise the people's spirits and consciousness to go out and struggle for a little bit more justice for poor folk. Can you imagine what an earth-shaking thing that can be? So I think these are the kinds of things that are very important. I don't want you all to think that me in particular, but scholars in general, are looking down. Look, I might have more gospel music in my collection than a whole bunch of y'all in here. I love gospel music. What you love, you engage. I'm not ignoring it. But more than anything, what's more important than anything is that we live in a society that is crushing poor people, that is crushing the lives of old people, that is purveying policies that are eroding our freedoms, policies that are degrading our environment, policies that are destroying the educational system of for our children. And if we say that that the earth belongs to God, and that we are trying our best to serve God, then I think the larger question is, how can we save this earth, and how can we turn this unjust world into God's kingdom of justice? And that's what I've tried to do in this book, to talk about ways we can do that, to give prescriptions. And I think that it got a little off the track, but I take Jesus very seriously. My work is about Jesus. Everything I've written is about Jesus, about the power of Jesus. And all I want us to do, and I hope you see, I hope you see in the politics of Jesus that there, all I want to do is raise the various ways where the power of Jesus is there that's not yet really called upon and tapped, being tapped in ways that we can tap it more and use it more to be more deeply spiritual people in the holistic way, that we love the Lord God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength, and be empowered with and by that relationship with God to love our neighbors as ourselves, which means we want to build the kind of world for our neighbors that we want for ourselves. That, to me, is the larger question. And that we can hold hands and go forward with together in Jesus' name to change this world. And so, as they say, on that great getting up morning, when it's all over.
Stop you performing.
Sometimes you got to do it, Pastor. I'm here to tell you. But when it's all over, we'll be able to say, you know, Lord, I had a good time because you gave me a world in which I could have a good time. I've enjoyed the good things of the world. But Lord, I've also taken the strength and the power and the love you've given me, and I've tried to help somebody. I've tried to feed somebody. I've tried to break down principalities and powers that are keeping people from being all that they could be. Lord, I've tried to open up this world so that all of God's children can eat from the tree of life in equal measure. And that, I think, is what we all can share together. We might disagree. But we can all hold hands together and say, loving Jesus means to me that I got to love my neighbor. And then I got to hate what Jesus would hate. And that is these policies that are being purveyed by these people on TV and these politicians, I'm not going to name them, but many of them call Republicans. And we must fight against them and call them out for what they are. They stand against the very thing they say that they believe in. They say they're people of faith. Well, I'm not sure what faith it is, but it's not the faith of the Bible that Moses and so many of the prophets and Jesus himself died for. Thank you so much, and I look forward to signing your books for you. Yeah.
Unfortunately, we are up against the clock. There may be opportunities to engage the panelists after. Pastor Mike, could you wrap things up for us? Before you do that, and give the benediction. I do want to thank the staff of the Institute for Research on African American Studies for helping us organize this, particularly Sharon Harris, who is not only a staff member, but a member here at First Corinthian. She talks about your church all the time.